1968, it was very normal to travel to Paris, to London, to Madrid, to Rome, Athens, and many other major European cities for a vacation. But no one knew anyone that would deliberately take a vacation behind the Iron Curtain. People heard about East Germans trying to escape the Soviet rule and how they would get killed trying to secure their freedom. So why were my father and I going on a holiday to East Germany, a country where people were desperately trying to leave? Most people thought it was foolish, that we were only asking for trouble. I disagreed. My father was very different, and to him, this trip back to Leipzig, Germany, his birthplace, was special. That 1968 trip to Leipzig was going to be his first trip back to his hometown since the war, a period that gapped 30 years. I was excited to be the only one to join him on that memorable trip. He shared with me where he lived, right here in this home, and other memories he had of his upbringing. He had many fond memories of his childhood until he was stripped of his youth because of Hitler and the genocide that followed. Whereas many World War II Holocaust survivors wanted to avoid any discussion of the war, my father wrote a book about his experiences in the concentration camp. He survived the war and wanted to share what he went through. He would talk about it with anyone that was willing to listen. Years later, after East Germany and West Germany were reunited as one country, Achie and his brother Herbie were invited back to Leipzig. Achie was very excited to once again go back, especially with his brother, who had been inseparable from since they were reunited towards the end of World War II. Yes, there were tearful moments because of what had happened, but Leipzig had always been a part of the fabric of who my father was, and he would be proud to now have a Stolperstein stone dedicated to each of his family members in the city that he once loved. Achie wrote in his book on the freighter, the William Floyd, when he was crossing the Atlantic from France to the USA in 1946, 1 year after the war had ended. It was not published till 1997, 40 years after it was first written. The book contained a foreword from renowned author and cousin, Edgar Hilsenrath, the author of the bestseller here in Germany, The Nazi and the Barber. Edgar commented how extraordinary Achie's book was and how vividly it portrayed unique aspects of the war that Achie had experienced firsthand. When the book was first written, Achie felt tremendous anger and hurt towards every German, as many of my father's closest family members were all victims of the Holocaust. That hurt would never fade, but some of the anger would ease as Achie saw a genuine effort by the Germans to address their crime 40 years after the war had ended. When Achie's book was published in 1997, he commented on those experiences of remorse. In his words, for 40 years under the communists, East Germany adamantly refused to acknowledge any responsibility for anything that might have happened there before 1945. According to the official line, the country had fallen into the grips of evil people and fascists, from whom it was finally rescued by the great friend of the German people, the Red Army. When the Iron Curtain fell, East Germany's first elected parliament, immediately upon convening, discarded all that cynical and evasive rubbish. In a candid and moving statement, it asked the forgiveness of Jews in particular, and expressed only shame and regret for what had happened. They offered reparations for the most heinous crime in history. The Germans seemed to understand well enough that they cannot simply walk away from Hitler's criminal legacy. My father was moved by that apology. He felt that Germany had finally admitted its guilt. To him, it was a very important step towards understanding and improving relations. He did not believe in burdening one generation with the sins of its forefathers. Achie continued, this would place us in the same category with the people who persecuted the Jews for centuries. The memory will always stay with us, but when a country shows its willingness to accept its guilt and offer its good faith and willingness to have improved relations with us, let us accept that offer and move one step towards them. Let us live together in a better world without the hate and the prejudice. Today we are forging ahead with one more step towards a better world with several Stolpersteine stone dedications. I believe will remind us of what hate and prejudice can produce. I also wish to share some of the thoughts of my son Kobe on why these Stolpersteine stone dedications are so important. In Jewish day school, Kobe was taught that we should never forget what happened in the Holocaust and that part of history was very real and emotional for him, having been a second generation offspring to a Holocaust survivor. Kobe feels that one part of the Stolpersteine stone concept is focused inward toward the Jewish community so that we must not forget, but a bigger part is making sure that others never forget as well. Kobe believes that commemorating our relatives through a memorial in a public place where future German children can walk by and view the stones and ask their parents the question, who are these people whose name adorn these stones? This is the ultimate way of never forgetting and reminding the Germans of their part in this historical atrocity. He felt that we can also reclaim what was once stolen from our ancestors, the stones that they once walked on daily as part of their homes, and how we can reclaim that part of their history and forever make an imprint on the cities where they once lived and where future generations of Germans will reside. Kobe shared that it is important that on occasions like this that our cultures and religions should be coming together, standing tall in the face of the hatred that was the catalyst to these atrocities. We cannot cave in to the hate and fear that were pressed upon the Jewish community so many years ago and still today. We still live in a world where atrocities like the ones in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, San Diego, California, and Paris, France happen, where Holocaust deniers are given public forum to speak their twisted versions of historical reality. It is for this reason that we must remain resilient and stand up to hate by committing to public display of commemoration and honoring those that fought to see another day, ensuring that we can live and regrow our communities. I want to thank Kobe for those impressionable words. To commence today's program, I want to give each of you some insight into what my father endured, as well as some of my other family members endured during that horrific period in time. But first, I want to thank Günter Demnig for introducing the Stolpersteine Stone Commemorative Program. It honors the memory of what occurred in Europe over 80 years ago, and what could occur once again if we as citizens fail to remember history's valuable lessons. It is good to see many municipalities across all of Europe embrace the Stolpersteine Stones. For each of these individuals that are affected by the horrors of World War II, it provides a memory and legacy within the community they once treasured, a community they once called home. I also want to thank Joachim Kalter in Leipzig for helping to coordinate this unique day of Stolpersteine Dedications. Leipzig has 2 days per year where they schedule their Stolpersteine Stone installations. So to be able to have 24 Stolpersteine Stone dedications for my family on one day was a huge task to coordinate, and my family is forever grateful for Joachim for putting it all together. I also want to acknowledge each of my relatives that elected to be part of this dedication. We have come from many parts of the world to honor our families. To be here with my wife, Bonnie, our daughter, Gabby, our son, Kobe, our future daughter-in-law, Stephanie, my sister, Cheryl, and I wish my brother-in-law, Ralphie, who unfortunately couldn't make it, would bring tears to my father. To also have my cousins, Steve Kaberski, with his son, Rafi, and daughter, Ronnie, Sonia Glassman, her granddaughter, Emma, Harriet Rubin, her sister, Joanne Drucker, all join us, makes the event a truly significant Kalter family event. It's a trip that each of us will remember forever. Many of our ancestors had their lives cut short, and many others endured unimaginable suffering through the Holocaust, which is regarded as one of history's most infamous crimes against humanity. My family history had roots in both Germany and in Poland. To provide a much more vivid picture of what we are honoring today, I prepared a historical background so many of these Stolpersteine dedications will have a much more meaningful explanation to each of us that have joined us today. Oskar, my grandfather, he was born in Tarnów, Poland in 1891. In 1910, he came to Leipzig, Germany to live as it had a good religious Jewish community and was known to be a place where there was an opportunity to make a living. He became a traveling salesman, selling household linens, sheets, and towels, mostly in Halle, a town 25 miles from Leipzig. He came home every night after work, his mother Hannah, his father Baruch, and his 6 living siblings, Isidore, Jacob, Josef, Erna, Frieda, and Sabrina, all followed him to live in Leipzig a few years afterwards, as it was a good place to live as a religious Jew. Unfortunately, 3 of his siblings, Baruch, Michal, and Perla, all died at a young age. Clara, my grandmother, was born in Leipzig in 1900. My mother, Frieda, and her father, Michal, were born in Kolomaya, Poland, where they met and married. They moved to Leipzig just before the turn of the century to start a new life in a flourishing Jewish community. Clara had 6 siblings, Dina, Sophie, David, Adolf, Bernard, and Fanny. Fanny died as a child. Clara met Oscar, and they married in 1920. Their wedding was right here in the zoo across the street. where many joyous events were celebrated. Two of Claire's brothers moved to Halle, where Oscar would interact with them in his sales efforts, as one of her brothers, David Hilsenrath, had a furniture store there. 1921, Manfred, my uncle, was born. 1923, Achie was born, and 26, Herbert was born. As a family, Oscar, Claire, and the three boys adhered to the Jewish traditions and religious ways. The Jewish community was tightly woven, and many family members lived very close to one another. They observed the Shabbat, had big get-togethers every Saturday after shul with the family Kiddush luncheon at the house. When Hitler assumed control in 1933, there were 520,000 Jews living in Germany. In 1933, Leipzig was the sixth largest Jewish community in Germany with 13,000 Jews. That would change very quickly. Some of the Kalter family members sensed the tides of change and recurring and started planning to leave Germany over the next few years. 1936, Clara's brother Adolf Kugelmass and his wife, Frieda, fled to the French countryside. 1937, Clara's brother Bernard Hilsenrath got a visa to Argentina. 1937, Clara's sister Sophie Hilsenrath fled with her husband Zelmer to France and then to Switzerland. 37, Oscar's sister Sabina and her husband Nathan got visas to the United States and settled in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. 37, Oscar's brother Josef applied for a visa to Switzerland for his whole family, including his wife Elsa and their two daughters, Rachel and Sonia, which permitted them to go there in December 38. Sonia's here today with her granddaughter Emma, her nephew Steve, and his children Rafi and Ronnie, for their family Stolpersteine Dedication, because of that Swiss visa that Sonia's father discreetly secured. 1938, Clara's brother, David Hilsenrath, fled to the French countryside, while his wife Anna and sons, Edgar and Fred, fled to Romania. They were reunited 8 years later, so 8 years they were apart during the war. Oscar's sister, Franja Peckel, her husband, Kurt Peckel, and their son, Abraham Peckel, left Leipzig before the war broke up and went to live near Paris. When the Germans occupied France, they were sent to the French Nexon and Drancy internment camps for Jews. Shortly thereafter, they were sent to Auschwitz in August 1942, where they were killed. The Nazi footprint would eventually stretch across all of Europe, and there were very few places to hide. By 1938, the Jewish population in Germany had declined to only 214,000. Oscar and Clara's family and many others had all assumed the worsening conditions for the Jews would eventually improve. The tides of politics historically have always moved back and forth, but this time conditions only worsened, far worse than anyone could have imagined. It was the fall of 38, the Kalters were living in Leipzig, and things are about to change and get very ugly very quickly. Oscar was 46, Clara was 38, Manfred was 17, my father was just 15, Herbie was 12. On October 6, 1938, the Polish Ministry of Internal Affairs announced an ordinance called Polonoxio, requiring that all Polish citizens living outside Poland obtain an endorsement stamp on their passports before October 30th. Over 57% of foreign Jews living in Germany were of Polish descent. With Jews losing their basic rights to live in Germany, as a human being, Poland felt threatened that a mass exodus of the 30,000 Polish Jews from the remaining 214,000 still living in Germany was very likely. Any passport without the stamp would thus become void, and the owner of the passport would have his Polish citizen rights revoked. At Polish consulates in Germany, almost all Polish Jews living in Germany who applied for the stamp were denied approval with the duplicitous intent to prevent them from returning to Poland as a Polish citizen. This required them to travel to Poland to get the stamp, which was costly and time-consuming. Germany knowingly wanted all Jews to leave in response to the Polish decree, fearing the prospects of thousands of Polish Jews being unable to legally emigrate from the Reich. The German government felt that it had to act. As head of the Gestapo, Reinhard Heydrich, who was born in the neighboring town of Halle, issued an edict that all Polish Jews be expelled from the Reich by October 30th, 1938. So on October 28th, 1938, in this building right here, the Gestapo came, knocked on the door of the Kalter family, telling them that each person should pack their clothes for 2 days. They were then taken by auto to the train station for deportation to Poland. Oscar's family, Clara, Achie, Herbie, and Manfred, took a train from Leipzig to Buchen on the German-Polish border. The train was packed entirely with Polish Jewish refugees. Achie decided to move his family back to his hometown in Tarnów, Poland. We had some degree of familiarity. Many of the other Kalter families also eventually moved to Tarnów, where they all resided as the war broke out. with the Nazi regime garnering strength with its early World War II victories, the carnage against all the Jews was about to take its toll on the entire Kalter clan. In April 1940, Ate was taken as a prisoner to the Pushkau concentration camp, which was 50 kilometers from Tyna. He would be a prisoner in multiple concentration camps until the end of the war, a duration of 5 years, which was remarkable to survive those type of conditions for such a length of time. In September 1942, Aki received news that his brother Manfred was deported to a crematorium. Herbie later shared to be the Belzec concentration camp. Then it was thought to be the Majdanek concentration camp. The information was always suspect that was provided by other prisoners of war, but the outcome was the same. Manfred, their brother, had died. In 2009, many years later, the Holocaust records from Bad Arolsen were finally allowed to be shared after 60 years of being regarded as confidential wartime documents, and news surfaced that Manfred was actually arrested in Tarnow in November 1943, ironically the same month that Herbie was deported from Tarnow to Auschwitz. He was later reported to be living after the war in a DP camp called Blinder in Ansbach, Germany, from January 46 to February 17, 1948. No further information was ever found out about Manfred. Sadly, no family members ever reconnected with him. In September 1942, Aki's grandfather, Baruch Kalter, was forced to dig his own grave in Tarnow, where he was then shot and killed. Today, we are not laying a Stolperstein stone for Baruch Kalter and his wife, Hannah, as Steve and his mother, Rachel and Sonia, were here 2 years ago to honor them with their dedication. We will walk by their stones later today to pay our respects. In November 1942, Aki's mother, Clara, was deported to the Belzec concentration camp, where she was put to death. In 1938, Tarnow had a thriving Jewish population of 25,000 Jews. Now, Oscar and Herbie and 300 other Jews were the only Jews still living in what is now the Jewish ghetto of Tarnow. In December 43, Oscar and Herbie are transported like cattle, packed in the trains for a three-day ride with no food or water to the Birkenau-Auschwitz concentration camp. Herbie, then 17, and Oscar, then 51, were not the ideal work candidates and were likely to be gassed. Herbie told his father to lie about his age and profession so they would get work detail and not be sent to the gas chamber. When Jews arrived at the platform in Birkenau, they were thrown out of the train cars without their belongings and forced to make two lines, men and women separately. The SS officers, including the infamous Dr. Joseph Mengele, conducted the selections among these lines, sending most of the victims to one side, condemning them to death in the gas chamber. Herbie told his father to say he was 40 years old and a very talented mechanic. Herbie said he was 20 and also a mechanic. They were both selected for work detail and given camp number tattoos. Herbie's number was 161306 and Oscar's 161311. Herbie and Oscar were given rock quarry duty for their four-week quarantine period. In week three, Herbie got typhus, was transported to the hospital. On his fifth day in the hospital, Herbie's fever broke. Herbie rubbed the thermometer to show that he still had a temperature, so he does not have to leave the hospital. A Polish orderly notices this and tells Herbie to stop, since the SS will be shipping all sick prisoners to the gas chamber that day. Very important that he looks healthy. Short while later that day, the SS officers did come by and did the selection. They saw that Herbie had no fever and was healthy, so he was fit to return to work that day. Upon his return to his barrack to look for his dad, he discovered that Oscar had been taken to the gas chamber while he was in the hospital. On July 26, 1944, Russians are approaching and Pushkau camp is evacuated. Aki and the other prisoners are loaded into freight cars and transported over an eight-day period to Birkenau-Auschwitz. On August 3, 1944, Aki arrives at Birkenau-Auschwitz with the SS receiving order at Auschwitz, who makes the selections determining who dies and who gets gassed, issued the order that all of the Pushkau prisoners were to be sent to the crematorium. The Pushkau camp commandant, Oberschauer Ruf, who accompanied the prisoners on the eight-day transport, objects very strongly. He had seen his workers perform many different types of work and knew of their immense talent to the Reich and value to the Reich and the German war effort. He interceded and asked to immediately call Berlin to communicate their value to the Reich. Berlin agreed that they should not be gassed, but instead be put to work. Atte was issued his camp number tattoo, A18160. In August 1944, Atte met a prisoner who shared news that his father was dead, but Herbie was alive, working as a valet for one of the camp commandants in Manowitz-Buna, a sub-camp of Auschwitz. Knowing that Herbie was alive provided Atte with great hope that he would soon be reunited with his brother, and they could both survive the war. In the fall of 1944, Herbie was given a note by a roof worker who had access to different camps within Auschwitz. The note was from Atte saying he was in the Auschwitz sub-camp of Gleiwitz. The roof worker told Herbie that Atte was weak and starved. Herbie then sent Atte back a note with the roof worker to tell him to try and get him to Manowitz-Buna. Herbie then approached the camp commandant, Rockers, and asked if Atte could be transferred. After many attempts, the commandant asked for Atte's ID number. In November 44, he was summoned to the front gate of the Manowitz-Buna concentration camp with no knowledge of why. He stood there waiting with Shimon Gutter, a friend of his from Tarnow. A truck then pulled up. Atte is thrown from the truck like just a sack of potatoes, and he laid on the floor, emaciated, looking like a living skeleton. He then stood up, smiled, being reunited with his brother, and saying to Herbie, "Look at you, you're all grown up." Herbie, through his connections, got Atte a job in the kitchen, which allowed Atte to eat better and get stronger. On January 18, 1945, orders administered to evacuate Auschwitz. All the Auschwitz prisoners, over 10,000, including Herbie and Atte, are forced to take a two-day, 40-mile death march to Leipzig in heavy snow, in just wooden clogs and thin uniform, with no food, no water, and dogs chasing them to make sure they march quickly. Many prisoners fell to the death and died there, right in the snow. On January 22, 1945, after the death march and 2 days in Gleiwitz, Herbie and Atte are put on a train transport. The SS put the prisoners on German transport freight trains destined for one of three concentration camps, Mauthausen, Sachsenhausen, and Buchenwald. Atte and Herbie were placed on the Buchenwald train. The freight trains were open with no roof, so staying alive with the cold, frigid winter air was hard, but magnified since they were packed like sardines with no heat, no water, and just a slice of bread thrown into the train daily for 8 days. Riots ensued, and the bread was being dispensed. Conditions were horrific. Daily, prisoners died on the train. Out of 3,000 prisoners on the Buchenwald train, 1,800 died. Only 1,200 survived to arrive in Buchenwald. February 13, 1945. After 2 weeks in Buchenwald, orders are administered to leave Buchenwald. Departing Buchenwald, they take a German troop train, which fortunately had a roof versus the Buchenwald train, which did not. Unfortunately, since it had a roof, the RAF could not see that there were prisoners inside and instead attacked it with machine guns, thinking it was transporting German soldiers. The Germans locked the train cars, which contributed to greater prisoner death by the RAF gunfire. Fire then broke out in Atte and Herbie's train. Smoke filled the car. Atte and Herbie, with other prisoners, broke their train car door and jumped out while it was moving. The RAF stopped firing once their store was filled with prisoners running from the train and not German soldiers. Out of 800 prisoners, only 500 survived, the other 300 killed by the Allies. Atte gets back on the train with Herbie. Atte then sees a good friend of his dead, with his face ripped apart by the RAF bullets. Death was bombarding them from both fronts. February 27, 1945. Atte and Herbie arrive in Langenstein, Zweibrücken. After 2 weeks of hard labor at Langenstein, Atte gets pneumonia and dysentery and goes to the infirmary. With no drugs to administer, the doctor told Atte it was just a matter of time. But one more miracle from Hashem allowed his emaciated body to overcome the adversities. On April 11, 1945, the American 18th Army Division arrives in Langenstein and officially liberates the camp. With Atte alive, surviving his bout with pneumonia and dysentery, Atte and Herbie were both very happy to now see the war end. They knew the war had taken 18 of their very close family members and many additional cousins as well. Each one felt that for them to have survived the war was a miracle, but to also have your brother survive was yet another miracle that made their own survival that much more special. Each had faced imminent death many times, and each one had divine intervention to protect them and keep them alive. They now vowed to always be close to each other, as they both felt that the bond of family is one of the most important things that life provides. that is a bond they kept their entire lives. During the Holocaust, the Jewish people were victimized with atrocities solely because of their religion. This tested many of the survivors who questioned how God could have permitted such an act to occur to his chosen people. Irby and Hathi knew it was the act of man and not God. They knew Jewish history. They knew there were many tyrants that previously tried to destroy the Jews, and each time, each of them had failed. And after each murderous attempt, the Jewish people rebuilt, prospered, and made strong contributions to the societies that embraced them and their culture. They knew this time would be no different, and as Jews, both Herbie and Afi knew it was very important for each of them to maintain their strong ties to their Jewish religion and heritage. As a Jew, one of the most important obligations a child has is to bring honor to their parents' memory. Today, I honor my father and his parents, not just by laying their Stolpersteine stone, by hoping to perpetuate the importance of the Jewish faith in our family lineage for many generations to come. Thank you.
My name is Cheryl Kalter-Schloss. I am Joachim Kalter's daughter. My dad knew death too well and the fragility of life from where he was merely a teenager. I knew the precociousness of my life, for I am named after his mother, my grandmother, Clara, who perished at the hands of the Nazis. My Hebrew name is Nechama, meaning sympathetic. My cousin Linda, who is Uncle Herbie's oldest daughter, has the same name. We are only named after someone who is no longer living. All my life, as far back as I can remember, I heard tidbits of Grandma Clara and Grandpa Oscar, their lives before in Leipzig. And all my life, I wish I had an Oma, an Opa. Yes, but more an Oma. I heard she was a great baker and her coffee clutches she enjoyed very much. Maybe we could have baked together or had tea or spent Shabbos together for a walk. I felt robbed because she was killed. I knew what the responsibilities of my life meant as a child of a survivor. In 1982, I was 30 years old. Under my persuasion, Dad and I went to Washington, D.C. for one of the first world gatherings of survivors and their children. Dad taught me to listen, for I sat at his knee in the big armchair, which is still in my living room today. And while he told us stories of his 6 years in Auschwitz and other concentration camps, we became his witnesses to the atrocities he suffered. He welcomed our questions, so we explored further. I was being groomed early to be a psychotherapist. We were his receptacles, his reservoirs, Craig and I, his memories and his historical knowledge. We told no one, there was no one to tell. Then the word Shoah was created, and survivor, and the experiences of the Holocaust began to be spoken, recognized and acknowledged, and we went to Washington, D.C. by bus. The world started to realize they needed to wake up to the atrocities and persecutions my father and Uncle Herbie went through, and the killings of my grandparents, uncles, and aunts and cousins that I never met. I ached with feeling robbed and cheated. In 1997, in January, my older son Jonathan Ariel became a bar mitzvah, which is a very special milestone in the Jewish religion. I asked my dad to please make a speech, and what follows are excerpts from that speech. I would like to address a few thoughts to my grandson Jonathan and to welcome everyone on this beautiful occasion of his bar mitzvah. I want to speak about his parsha. That is a section in our Torah. It's called B'shalach, which means to be set forth. This parsha contains three important themes. The first theme was the miracle of the Israelites' exodus from Egypt. The second theme was the hardship and deprivation of the desert. And the third theme was the Amalekites' attack on the unarmed Israelites. While the people were camping at Rephidim, they were attacked by the Amalekites. The Amalekites were nomadic people that lived in the Sinai, and they were the first of many foes they considered the arch enemy of the Jews. And this sentiment is reflected in an old portion of the Midrash. Moses wrote about the judgment of the Amalekites. Let all men know that those who harm the Israelites will come themselves to harm. The Amalekites will be remembered for their brutality and cunning in trying to destroy the Jews. Therefore, the Jews remember the Amalekites, and we would consider any foes of the Jews Amalekites. Haman, as described in the Megillah Esther, which we celebrate in our holiday of Purim, was a descendant of the Amalekites. Why am I so familiar with this poor part of history? 61 years ago, I was bar mitzvahed in my home, which is in the hometown of Leipzig, Germany. We were living under the shadow of the Nazi regime. My seder was the same as my grandson, Jonathan, has today. Little did I know that I would have my own Bishalach. My family was deported to Poland 1 year before the war broke out. As a result of this deportation to Poland, Kristallnacht occurred. It was the beginning of the Holocaust. I did my exodus and continued my starvation and torture in 5 concentration camps over a period of 6 years. There are a lot of similarities with my family's plight and the exodus in the Bible. The most important factor was that the Jewish people prevailed and the modern Amalekite was totally destroyed. It was a pyrrhic victory somehow. Never in history had people suffered that much from an enemy. The Egyptians, Crusaders, and the Spanish Inquisition had only limited goals: conversion, slave labor, or exile. This war was a war of total annihilation and extermination. In this light, it is especially heartwarming and significant that my first and oldest grandson repeated the same sedra after 3 generations. For me, I am grateful to be present for this occasion, and may God give me strength and help to be here for future occasions. And so, after 70 years, we are standing in front of my father's home for the Stolpersteine ceremony, giving him coveted honor and recognition to his parents, Oscar and Clara, and brother Manfred, Uncle Herbie, and of course, my dad. I feel your neshama, your spirit, is shining upon us today with koach, with strength. And may the memory of all of their lives inspire us to live more meaningful Jewish lives, so that we may help to ensure that a part of who they all are will still endure forever. This year marks my dad being gone from our lives 18 years. In the Jewish religion, 18 is special. It means high and it means life.
I would like to focus on all the things that we can be grateful for. And number one, I would like to say thank you to all the people who have been involved in the teaching and organizing of this ceremony and in general the whole program. So thank you to everyone. Some of the students didn't follow us, but I know there are many people that have helped. I am also grateful, of course, for being here and having our younger family here, which gives me great pleasure. And the fact that I can come back to the place where I was born after all these years, I'm very grateful for that. One thing also, you know, I was lucky. My sister, even though we went through all kinds of hardships and my father lost his family, we were a family and we had our lives in Switzerland. We were immigrants in Switzerland and refugees, but we had our family and we had our lives, and I'm always grateful for that. And my parents' courage and persistence and probably optimism to overcome all those things. So there are many things to be grateful for. And again, I thank you all for being here. Thank you.
Sag nicht kein Mal, als du gehst dem letzten Weg. Himmeln bleiene verstellen blaue Tag. Kommen wird doch unser ausgebänkte Schor. Sveta poikt an unser Trott, mir sennen do. kommen wird doch unser ausgebänkte Schor. Zweta peugt an unser Trott, wir sehnen do. Von grünem Palmenland bis Land von weißem Schnee. Wir kommen an mit unser Pein, mit unser Weh. Und wo gefallen sie, so spritz von unser Blut. Sprotzen wird dort unser Gwure, unser Mut. Und wo gefallen sie, so spritz von unser Blut. Sprotzen wird dort unser Gwure, unser Mut. Es wird die Morgensonne begilden uns dem Heid. Und der Nächten wird verschwinden mit dem Feind. Nur heut versammeln wird die Sonne und der Kajor. Wie a Parol soll gehen das Lied von dort zu dort. Nur heut versammeln wird die Sonne und der Kajor. Wie a Parol soll gehen das Lied von dort zu dort. Das Lied geschrieben ist mit Blut und nicht mit Blei. Es ist nicht kein Lied von a Fegel auf der Frei. Das hat a Volk zwischen Fallen dicke Wend. Das Lied gesungen mit Naganes in die Hand. Das hat a Volk zwischen Fallen dicke Wend. Das Lied gesungen mit Naganes in die Hand. Sag nicht kein Mal, als du gehst dem letzten Weg. Wenn Himmeln bleiene verstehen blaue Tag. Kommen wird doch unser ausgebänkte Schor. Sveta peugt an unser Trott, wir sehnen durch. Kommen wird doch unser ausgebänkte Schor. Sveta peugt an unser Trott, wir sehnen durch.
זו דרכו של
יגן לך וישמור ממשבר סוף הבקור בלילות של אהבה הוא יהיה חלקת שלווה
Start with a Hebrew song, just the title of it. It's called Lekol Ish Yesh Shem. It means that everyone has a name. Each of us has a name. Each of us has a name that was given to us by our parents. And I think that this project and this particular dedication here really focuses on the name and on the people. So I'll give a little story here. Last week, or 2 weeks ago, was Holocaust Remembrance Day in Israel. And this name of the song, Lekol Ish Yesh Shem, is the name of a ceremony where in the Remembrance Hall, they read out aloud the names of the victims of the Holocaust. And Isidore Kalter and Yeti Kalter and Joseph Kalter's names are read. And they read the names that day, one by one, one after the other. It's very emotional, it's very much part of the tradition and part of the culture. I live in Israel now, I grew up in the U.S. Another interesting symbolic point is that my mother, who was born here in Leipzig, as Achim mentioned, and later got out on the Kinder transport and later moved to America, her last years were spent in Israel, where she passed away 7 years ago, and she lived a full life till the age of 90. And interestingly enough, she passed away on Holocaust Remembrance Day, so that there's a lot of symbolism here. My mother was born Elfrieda Kalter, and we knew her as Faye. Her cousins called her Friedel. Another interesting connection is that I was here in this place with my mother, and that was 16 years ago. And all of these new structures were not here. It was an old building that was being renovated. So I convinced my mom to come here to Leipzig. She was 81 when she agreed to come, which means that she'd left here when she was 16, so she hadn't been back here 65 years. And she didn't want to come at first. A difficult decision to come back where you lost your whole, the last time you saw your whole family and then lost them. But she came for me because I said, I want to come and see where you're from. So we stood right here, we took some pictures, we didn't go in, but it was very memorable. And the thing I remember most is that at the train station, when we got to Leipzig from Berlin, from the Bahnhof, 65 years, right? And she just remembered where everything was. She wanted to like pull me. We had to check into the hotel and she said, no, let's go to the neighborhood. And she knew exactly where to go and she remembered everything. And I also have some photos of when she was here as a child. So now I'm here again without my mom and honoring her and of course our uncle, my sister and my brother and I's uncle, and grandparents, Isidore Kalter, who was, Hebrew name was Israel Mendel, my brother was named after him, and Yeti Kalter, I was named after her. She was born in Leipzig, as Achim mentioned, and we're here to honor them. And unfortunately, as Cheryl mentioned earlier, these are the uncles and grandparents that we never knew, that we lost and never knew and felt all the years that we were, you know, children without a grandparent on this side. So we don't know much about them, but I'll tell you a few things that I think I do know, or at least heard. One thing is that in 1938, and Achim mentioned this before in German, they were going to deport the Jews who had originally been born in Poland, like Isidore, and yet they had hidden or they weren't home, and so they weren't deported then, and only they were, though, a year later. There's more to the story, but that's the basic story. And they left Leipzig in 1939, I think it was August. And now comes the part that I know better, more about what happened just before that. They decided to try to get everybody out if they could, and they weren't so successful. But they heard about something, if you heard of it, the Kinder transport. And they decided to put my mother to get the right documents and to get my mother a passport, which was difficult, and to have her brought hopefully to safety in England on the Kinder transport. And that's exactly what happened. She was at the age of, how old are all of you here? 17. So she was 16 going on 17, my mother at the time. And she went on to the Kinder transport, which meant that she had to say goodbye to her parents and her brother, and not knowing what that would lead to. And the end that we know, the sad end, the tragic end, is that she never saw them again. So that at a young age of teenage, like a high school kid, she was uprooted and came to a new country, England. In the meantime, she didn't know what was happening to her parents, and only found out in 1945 from Craig and Cheryl's father and uncle, Herbie and Joachim, that her father, what he mentioned before, her father was shot in Tarnow in front. They pulled him out of his house with his other brother, Jacob, and they were shot to death. So my mother only found this out in 1945 by hearing the testimony of her cousins. And that her mother, Yeti, and her brother, Joseph, were sent, deported to the camps. And we don't have much information more than that, just to know that they perished, that they died, that they were murdered, killed. So I guess in 1945, my mother realized she was an orphan, without a family. But I think the part that we do is, my sister and I and my brother, as children, this was difficult for us to understand, and we never really asked our mom much about this period. We were afraid to say, how did you feel, how was that? But and when we did ask her, or other people asked her, she would say, I don't remember. So I think that she probably didn't remember. It was too traumatic to remember the separation. But she did have memories, and she did have good memories. And the memory she had of Leipzig that she told us was to go to the park that's still here, Rosenthal Park. And she went to the school here, the Kalabach School, and she used to ice skate in the park. And she remembers that she was part of a Jewish Zionist youth movement, and that she used to sing songs in Hebrew. And so all her memories of living here were, at least what we heard, were positive and lovely. And that the family was a close-knit family, and they would all get together on the Sabbath, on Shabbat, and say the prayers and say the Kiddush and get together, and they were close. So if I kind of now go to maybe more present times, despite this tragedy and trauma, my mother then in England had to make a new life and volunteered for the army. And she was in the army during the war in England. And then when the war ended, she was able to get to the US from one of the uncles who gave her an affidavit of support, and she arrived in the US. And there is where she started a whole new family. She met my father. She had three children. I'm the oldest. My brother, Ira, is in the middle, and Joanne is the youngest. My parents, my mom got married, and they lived to see five grandchildren. So that's my three children, who are Hilah, Gilad, and Ephrat. They were born in Israel. They have Hebrew names. And my brother's children, Corey and Lindsay. And when they passed away, they were each, my father and mother lived a long life. My father passed away in 88. My mother was almost 90. And since they've passed away, we have now also two great, what would be for them, great-grandchildren, and another one on the way. So that I guess the message, or the part that we'd like to get across to all of you is the thriving, still Jewish, still strong, still proud community that we continue to build and hope will continue on. So I would like to just say that only when I became a parent did I realize or think about, aside from my mother's tragedy, which was of course one of separation and loss, what about my grandparents? What kind of people were they? And as a parent myself, it's only then that I realized how difficult that decision must have been for them, for Isidore and Yeti to be so brave and so selfless and so sacrificing to decide to take one of your children and separate from them and put them to safety, to hopefully a better place. And that's the part I think that's most difficult and really deserving of a lot of respect and pride and honoring them. So that here we are honoring all of them. And I think that, you know, our mom, when I went to the cemetery the other week to pay my respects for her passing, I said to her, I don't usually talk to a gravestone, but I said to her, there's going to be a Stolpersteine, you know, dedication here for all the family. And I would imagine that she would have been happy and proud, but I think she would have said, oh really, don't make too much of a fuss. And you know, she didn't like too much of a fuss or fanfare. She was a very quiet, kind, someone who didn't want people to worry about her. She always worried about everybody else. She never complained throughout her life. She never had a bad word to say about anyone. And I think my sister and I and my brother like can't really understand that exactly, because there was a lot to complain about. But we appreciated and her kindness and her caring. And I would imagine that she inherited these traits from her parents, should live on, and we should all be that way. So thank you for coming.
Sod, was David hat gespielt vor Gott, nur dir wird's nicht gewähn, als er Jeschua. Und man singt das so, a far, a soul, a mische Berg hebt a kohl, der Duller meilig webt a Halleluja. Deine Munde ist gewollen schwach, Bosheva bot sich auf dem Dach, ihr Chaim, die Levone, dein Refuhe. Und sie nimmt dein Guff, sie nimmt dein Kopf, sie schneidet von deiner Haare Zopp und zieht von Mäuel an Robbe, Halleluja. Und teure, ich kenn dein Stil, Ich bin geschlafen auf dein Deal, ich hab kein Mal nicht gelebt mit der Satznuhe. Nur ich seh dein Schloss, ich seh dein Fond, ein Herz ist nicht kein Melchs Thron, es ist ein kalte und ein kalte, ja, Halleluja. Und wie ein Molto sag mir eus, was tut sich dort in dein Scheuss, Du wusch darfst dich schämen wie ein Psoe. Und gedenk, wie ich hab in dir geruht, wie die Schiene glut in unser Blut und jeder rot im Tod, Halleluja. Gott ist gar nicht da und Liebe soll sein Kolm roh a Pust der Träum zerbrochen und mich hole sind ich kein Gewehen in Mitternacht nicht kein Waldschuwe aufgewacht nur an Elmte Kolkeure Halleluja und ab ich Keures rufst du mich Mit Shem Hawaii läster ich, nur meile, ich der Wart nicht kein Gehule. Nur es brennt sich heiß in jeden Oss, von Aleph Beis gor bis in Sof, die Heilige und Kalle, Halleluja. Halleluja. Das ist alles, das ist nicht keine Sache. Ich mach derweile, was ich mach. Ich komm da wie ein Mensch, nicht kein Schaluje. Ich hab alles verloren, sei wie sei, will ich verleuben, Adonai, und schreien will ich heim. Halleluja, Halleluja. Hallelujah.
Kinderjorn, süße Kinderjorn. Ewig bleibt ihr wach in mein Sikorn. Wenn ich tracht von eurer Zeit, werd mir also ich bang und leid. Oi, wie schnell bin ich schon alt geworden. Steht mir noch das Stiebel vor die Augen. Wo ich bin geboren, aufgezeugen. Euch mein Wiegel seh ich dort, steht noch auf demselben Ort. Wie ach, hole mich das Salz verfleugen. Euch mein Wiegel seh ich dort, steht noch auf demselben Ort. Wie ach, hole mich das Salz verfleugen. Und mein Mame, ach, mich pfleg sie lieben. Gott, sie hat in Heider mich getrieben. Jeder Knieb ist von ihr Hand mir noch also gut bekannt. Gott, kein Zeichen ist mir nicht verblieben. Kinderjorn, junge, schöne Blume. Zurück zu mir wird ihr schon mehr nicht kommen. Von der Stube nicht stock ein Fleck, Fregele ist euch habe. Oi, wie schnell bin ich schon alt geworden. Von der Stube nicht stock ein Fleck, Fregele ist euch habe. Oi, wie schnell bin ich schon alt geworden.